reluctantly crouched at the starting line. Engines pumping and thumping in time. The green light flashes, the flags go up.
Well, here we are at Bloomer Park, our home course for Rochester Adams Cross Country. We will be seeing a lot more of it this season than we have in past seasons. This morning we were supposed to get it painted, but due to the lack of outdoor sports we've had, the painting machines for the RCS grounds crew are currently malfunctioning. We found that out this morning. So we're still going to take a look at the course, and we just won't have the official lines in our video. But many of you have been to this course before, and so you're aware of where it is you're going to go. Now, when it comes to a cross-country course, there's a few things you need to remember. Number one, it's not a track, so it's not going to be perfectly flat. There's going to be flaws. There's going to be dangers, if you will. Things like roots, loose sand, rocks, maybe even mole holes or groundhog burrows, all sorts of things that you could encounter. So it's important that when you're running to make sure you have a good visual of the ground that you're going to be running toward. So make sure you're not sitting too close to someone's shoulder if you're trying to race someone. Make sure you can see your own footing. Because if you're in the lead, you can see where that route is. If you aren't in the lead and you're too close to that person in front of you, you could roll an ankle. We've had that happen numerous times at numerous courses. So make sure you're able to see where it is you are going, where that foot's going to fall. The other thing you have to know about a cross-country course is how it's lined. A proper cross-country course has a series of what are known as barriers. Barriers are things that you run around. They could be natural barriers, like a tree, or they could be man-made barriers like the backstop of a baseball diamond. They can be temporary barriers like an orange cone. These barriers are the turns in your course. The purpose of a line is not to show you exactly where to run, but rather to show you where the next barrier is going to be located. So if I were to look at this line and I can see that it's going to go around a tree, all right, I need to run to the tree. I don't need to run directly on the line, I need to run to the tree. Once that line goes around the tree, I look to see where that line goes next. Okay, it's going around a cone. I just have to worry about getting to the cone. I don't have to follow the line. The machines that lay down the paint, they're like ginormous snow blowing machines. But instead of an auger that shoots snow, it's got a big, huge location to put tons of paint, and it's got a little sprayer poking out to the side, which means that if this machine is going right down the middle of a trail, the line is actually going to be painted on the left or on the right-hand side. So there's limitations as to where the line can be drawn. So if it's going around a turn, us runners would usually take the inside as close as we can to that turn. Well, the machine might be spraying paint on the outside. A straight line from point to point might not be drawn straight for various reasons. Usually the cross-country coach isn't the one behind the wheel of the machine. They're out front kind of using the measuring device, and someone's behind them with the machine, so occasionally the line might wiggle a little bit. You don't need to follow the wiggling line. You go from point to point, from barrier to barrier, from turn to turn. So make sure any course you're at, including our course here at Bloomer, make sure you look at that line and you see where is the next turn. You can do it during the race. You can also do that during your warm-up, checking out different locations. Now, nowhere is the location line more error prone than at a start. At your starting line, you've got all these teams lined up, all these athletes lined up, and so you've got this real wide starting line, and there is a single course line going out to that first barrier. So, perfect example here at Bloomer. So if we take a look at our starting line takes us out in this direction, and right over there, there is a garbage can. And we would see that during our warm-up. We would find out, oh, okay, that garbage can there is our first turn. So what am I going to do? I'm going to run to the garbage can before I make my right-hand turn. So if I start here at the starting line, I'm going to run straight to that garbage can. If I take some steps over here, I still run straight to the garbage can. what I shouldn't do if I'm on the right-hand side or the left-hand side of the starting line. What I shouldn't do is take off and run straight into where that line is and then follow the line out. Get to that barrier. So at the beginning of any race, at any course, what you need to do is you get a look out to that distance. Where is my first barrier and which way do I turn? Because I'm running in a straight line right to it. We've had races where the crowd is kind of crowded in a little bit at the start. And if that's the case, don't you worry, I will be there to get everybody moving back. Say, my team is running right through here, you guys gotta move back. We've done that plenty of times. So at that starting line, find that first turn. And once you find that first turn, know which way you're gonna turn, you run straight to it. Now, when I measure the length of the course, what I use is my measuring wheel. So my measuring wheel here is this little wheel that goes around. And on this wheel, if we take a look, we'll find it. Where are you? Right there. So what we'll find is that on this wheel, there's this little notch. This little notch goes through, and every time it pushes on this right here, and it causes our timer, our measurement, to go up one. So if I kind of roll it forward, it clicks over to 407, 408. And it goes another time around. And it goes from 408 to 409. So every time this little tab right here, every time this little tab goes around, it clicks over one. And wouldn't you know it, the circumference, the distance around the outside edge of this wheel is exactly 1 meter. So as I go through, I know every time I get a click, I get exactly 1 meter. And what I do is I literally walk the entire course. I don't run it. I walk the entire course, and I walk from barrier to barrier, and I put that wheel where a single runner would go. So they'd go around the turn on the inside, they'd run a straight line to the next one, and so I just wheel where a runner would go. So other coaches, parents, athletes that come running up to me with their GPS watch, I just measured the course with my GPS watch, and you're off, but no, I'm not off, thank you, we are not off. This device is gonna be perfect. When we're in the trees, when we're doing lots of turns, our GPS watch loses a lot of its accuracy. So thank you for the concern, but our course is going to be exactly 5,000 meters. Now, if you're in a group of runners and you're forced to the outside, if you don't take the most direct route because you're busy following the line that's not drawn most efficiently, then maybe you're running 5,010, 5,020 meters. It adds up. So you want to make sure you are running the most efficient route possible. Okay, so now let's go check out the course. We'll stop at a few spots to highlight a few things to note so that when you're out here racing for maybe your first time ever, you know certain landmarks and you know certain strategies to take into each of these locations. Okay, so here we go. Okay, so here's that first turn. Okay, right, here's our first barrier, this garbage can. There is our starting line over there. So we come here, this is what we're aiming for. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna be going down this trailway right here. There's a few lines already painted from a different course. We can use those lines to help illustrate a few things, but we don't need to worry about those in this video. So this right here, 125 meters to this turn. If we look down here, it's still got a little bit of openness so that we can maybe maneuver, pass, whatever else. But once we get in there, it's gonna be a little bit narrow and it's gonna be a little more challenging to pass. So does that mean you sprint the first 125 meters to get in the lead? No. But that first little bit does have to be a little bit higher intensity just so that you're in the proper group. You don't wanna be stuck behind runners that are slower than you, because down this trail, and many other trails on many other courses, the narrow trails, they're hard to pass. So you want to make sure you're in the proper location before you get into those narrows. All right, here we go. It's a beautiful day, sun beat down. I heard the radio walk, I was driving. The trees went by. Now here we start to see some of the first signs of uneven terrain. So a lot of rains will wash out our trail every now and again. So the park always comes in, they put in more sand, they put in more gravel, they put in wood chips. So if you can take a look right here, we've got some wood chips, we've got some unevenness in the terrain. So this is where you want to make sure you can see your footing. Now, there's always going to be little bits of orange or pink paint in different locations where there's some hazards, but there's no way that the coaches or the grounds crew, there's no way we could find every single one of them, so you gotta be paying attention. So make sure you can see where your feet are gonna land, okay?
Me and Dale were singing Little Runaway. I was flying.
Now you don't notice a big manhole cover here, kind of in the middle of nowhere. That's a good marker for us, because we know that our quarter mile, our 400 meter mark is coming up. Obviously, you don't want to trip and fall on that. Lots of orange things painted here so that hopefully you can see that and not crash. So make sure you're paying attention to that. Now, as we walk up here just a little bit further, as you can see, this trail is not very wide. This is why make sure you're in the proper location before you get into those narrows in terms of passing people and everything else. So part of the racing strategy is make sure you're in the right spot before the narrows, which are hard to pass, before they show up. All right, so if we look right here, just past the manhole cover, we got lots of brush on this side, and then we get to a spot where it's open. And so you can see right here, there's an opening, and it's easier to see in person, of course. This opening is the 400 meter mark. That's one quarter mile. That's one lap of our track. And since we're gonna have a goal mile for that first mile, we have a goal time to hit, you can check that watch right here. You'll have already done the math in your head. You know that, okay, if I'm trying to run this time for my first mile, that means at the 400 meter mark, I should have this time. And to be honest, whatever time you think you should have mathematically, it's probably gonna be just a little bit faster, because that first 125 meters, you're gonna take off with a little extra speed, so your pace might be off a little bit, but that's okay. You'll settle right into that normal pace, and that's exactly the way it's supposed to go. So right here, this clearing, that's your 400 meter mark. So a good thing to check off as you are running through. All right, so let's continue on down. You're gonna notice that we have lots and lots of sand, loose sand here. Obviously a nice little footprint there in the loose sand. So this whole beginning stretch is a lot of loose sand. So just make sure you're aware of that when you're running. Obviously you don't get as good a grip, but it is what it is.
Yeah, running down a dream that never would come to me. Working on a mystery. Felt so good, like anything was possible. Hit cruise control and rub my eyes. The last 3 days, and the rain was unstoppable. It was always cold.
Okay. Don't mind me being a little out of breath. So right here, as we come up, we're going to see this yellow sign. It says wrong way. You don't need to worry about that. That's from the mountain biking course. For us, this right here is exactly 800 meters, one half of a mile, essentially, into our race. So again, you'll have an idea of what that time should be ahead of time, before your race. We do the math. And here's a great time to check the watch as well. If your 400 meter mark over there was a little off because you started off with a little bit of a sprint, this one should be a little bit more accurate. Still, you might be a second or two faster than what you were hoping, but that's okay. You took off a little bit quick, that's okay. Okay. So if you forget about the yellow sign, you've got the little pit toilet right there. There's a couple different paths here, and our solid line, this line is from a different race. Our line is gonna take us up here through the woods as we continue. Now, as I had mentioned before, it's cross country. You're not running on a flat surface necessarily. So you take a look at all of the routes. We tried to color them in yellow and orange. And some of these roots, they are huge. You can see how big they are compared to my hand. Easy to trip over these, so you gotta make sure you are watching your footing. I'd like to tell you that these are the worst roots that are out there, but that'd be a lie. All right, here we go, continuing on. Okay, this part might look familiar because we already came through here. We came from our starting line over here and went through. Big loop around. Now we're coming back out. So now we are actually headed back out to where the starting line is, where all the fans are going to be. So it's nice and quiet back here. Once we get to that turn, there's going to be lots of fans out there. And it's going to be noisy and get the adrenaline pumping and everything else. So, so we're approaching where we had started, actually. Wherever it leads, running down a dream. Okay, so now, as we come through, if we take a look back over here, this is all pretty clear. There's trees, there's not a lot of brush. We get to right here, the brush starts again. That's significant to us because where the brush starts, I even have a little orange spot here on the ground, but that'll fade with time. This right here is the 1,000 meter mark. Now, this is America, we don't do metrics, unfortunately, but if the 1K mark is something that you are interested in, and if you think about it, it's a 5K, a 5,000 meter race, here's 1,000. Right here, if you keep that pace, times five. There's no 0.1 miles to add at the end. That's 1,000 meters, that's 1/5 of your race. So not common, but not a terrible split to know. Not every course is gonna have the 1,000 mark, but we know where it is. It's not gonna be marked officially, but that's where our 1,000 is, so we can use that as well. So from the clearing to where the brush begins, that's gonna be our 1,000 meter mark. Okay, now here's a really good example of the point-to-point barrier idea. If you look over my shoulder, our trail is gonna enter right there, a little dark spot. But our white line is going this way. If there's no barrier, you're going to go straight that way. And unfortunately, we've been to races where the line is where you're supposed to go, but the people that set up the course don't bother putting cones. And what do the smart runners do? We're cutting this one. So for us, our line goes to the left and swings around because there's gonna be cones there. So that's why I'm gonna hang left here and then take a right, even though right now as it is, that would be the most direct route. But there are gonna be cones right here, so we are going to eventually swing around there. So keep that in mind. That's why we're following the line here instead of going straight there. I put the pedal down to make some time. There's something good waiting down this road. I'm picking up whatever is mine. I'm running down a dream that never would come to me. Working on a mystery, going wherever it leads. Running down a dream. Okay, so out of the woods, back into the woods, out of the woods again. Now here's our big field. Our finish line is going to be across the field here. Our starting line's over there. This is when you come out of the woods, fans again, that surge of adrenaline. And right in the stretch right here is where our 1 mile mark is going to be located. There's always someone from some team or a parent or someone shouting out times. You've got your watch. Some races, they even have a big old clock so you can just see it without having to listen for someone's voices, because some of us just can't hear when we're running because you're so focused. So right here as we go around, back into the woods, right about here where I'm standing, is gonna be our mile mark, our 1600 meters. So technically 1609 is a mile, This is going to be the 1600, which is four laps of the track exactly. So you have some good idea. We typically call that a mile, of course. So right here, got a little orange mark. That's going to be our mile location. So a good place to check. We're going to be going back into the woods here. So once again, silence from the crowd as they see us go through here. So a little coaching point of mine. I'm usually in a location where I can see the mile, but I'm never there because it's too loud, it's too noisy, and if I wanted to impart on you any coaching wisdom, you couldn't hear it here. So I always find the quieter location. So you'll never find me at the mile. So if you're looking for me, don't look here. After the mile, we're going to encounter this a second time. This is where we've got some massive roots. This is only the beginning, but these roots here, they are huge. They're painted in pink. We keep on painting them again and again, but they are enormous. If you get down kind of eye level to see how big they are. So make sure you can see your footing. There's going to be some that are even bigger as we continue down this little trail here for about another 100 meters. They're even bigger at the end. And you got to come through this way a second time. So watch your footing. Okay, so here, another good example of the whole following, not following the line. Our course comes out and it goes around this tree and out. Where is that line going to be drawn? Most likely it's going to be this line right here. Again, this is not our course, but it's the same stretch. And this is where the machine's probably going to paint it down. Grass, the paint stays longer than if you paint it in the dirt over here. So when you're coming out here, skip the grass. Aim right through there. Just because someone else on another team isn't doing that, it's not your problem. So that's how it's being wheeled. If you do that, you are still running the 5,000 meter course. You are not cutting it short. All right? A little bike traffic here. Additionally, this is where I will be. So I can stand right out here in the opening. I can actually see the mile mark. So I can see where you're at when you go through. But right here is usually me, maybe one or two other people. It's quiet, nice little downhill coming through right here. And this is where we kind of really begin that second mile. So I will give you some second mile advice. And that advice is probably gonna be, okay, time to move up. That first mile, we worry about the pace. The second mile, we worry about our place. Slowly catching up to people throughout that whole second mile. And that's probably gonna be what I tell you, something along those lines right here. Nice little downhill to give you a little boost of speed as we come out here back to the crowd again. Okay, lots of roots. Again, what else is new? So this right here is where you're gonna have lots of teams hanging out, parents, spectators, etc. It's where we go off to the second part, the second portion of our course on the north side. But right through here, on your way through this way, when you get from the grass to this little dirt section, right in here, and again, we don't have it marked exactly, but right about here in the middle is the 2,000 meter mark, the 2K mark. So again, if you're going with 1,000 meter increments and you want to check your time, that's what you have right here. So again, not very common for us to do that, but if that's something that you've done, take your 5K time, divide it by five, and figure out what your pace should be here, another good spot where you can check. All right, so here we are up and over the cement. So yes, you have spikes, and those spikes are sharp little pieces of metal, and yes, they get dull when you step on things like rocks and cement and asphalt. So that's just one of those things where you just a couple steps over and you're over it. So just be aware that's gonna happen. Now, as we walk up here, another great example. We're going around these two yellow markers and then eventually around that garbage can right there. And where does our line take us? Way over here on the right hand side. All right, so if I kind of give you a little perspective of just how big this is, so you look here, I mean, I can put my hand over here, and if I stretch my hand that way, I'm touching the line. So that's 6 feet. I definitely don't want to be this far away from the pole when I'm taking my turn. I know being right next to that pole is going to be where I want to go. So what's the line telling me? The line's showing me, hey, the next barrier is this. And you got to take a left-hand turn. Take it on the inside. Now, the race course that Bloomer has takes you this way. Ours is slightly different. We're going to actually go to the right around this this grill right here. There will be a line, but it takes us away. There's a couple routes through there. Going this way takes us around those routes so we can avoid any rolled ankles. You notice this line going from tree to tree. It just zigged this way, now it's zigging that way, zigging back this way. So keep it straight, keep it straight. Okay, so we have entered the north side of the park. We're going back into the woods again. A lot of roots, a lot of chunks of rock, lots of nasty stuff here. Pay attention, watch your footing. But what's significant right here, 2,500 meters, halfway exactly. So a mile, 0.55, a little more than a mile and a half. So there is no mark. Just realize that when you start to enter the woods, we're gonna do a hard right here following the white line. Once we get there, you're halfway through. Now there's a picnic table right here. Any picnic tables that are in the way, I'm gonna make sure that they are removed before the race. But from this tree right here, we are going to that little end of the line and taking a left. This white line hugs the trees. It's my hope that when we paint our own line, we don't do that, because I'm gonna tell our liner straight that way. If the white line doesn't go that way, well, that's which way you're running, because that's how I wheel it. We're going around that barrier. So this table will be out of the way, straight there. Sometimes it's just natural for us to want to kind of hug the tree line. Do it if you want, but you're going to be adding extra meters to your race. Nobody wants to do that. Okay, we are about to encounter our next section of narrow trailway. Not only is it narrow, it's going to be downhill. Now, we haven't done any downhill training yet, so I haven't had a chance to talk to you all about running downhill, but basically you run as fast as you're comfortable with. If you're slowing down, you're using energy to slow down rather than let gravity just pull you on down. But at some point you get too fast and it's just too dangerous. Especially at the end of a day, end of a race, your legs are a little bit fatigued. So you go as fast as is safe. But it's going to be narrow, it's going to be downhill, it's going to be hard to pass. And as we get into this location, I'll be standing right over there. And what I'm going to yell to you is either sprint, quick little surge to catch up to the people that are in front of you. That way you can kind of tail them on down, or maybe pass someone right at the very end so that you're in the lead, you get the good visual, and you are the person that has to be passed by someone else. So sometimes it's good to throw in a little surge, a little sprint, to either catch up to a group, and then you can kind of catch your breath and recover while sitting right off their shoulder, or maybe to pass a couple extra people so that on the way down you can have that advantage. Now as we go down this one, rocks, roots, loose sand, we got the trifecta, and going downhill with, you know, elevated speed. So make sure you're careful, make sure you can see your footing. Don't just run blindly behind somebody else, right? And while you're here, you can also look for deer. So besides maybe seeing some deer like we just did, when you're coming through here, 3,000 meter mark. So we just went around here. A little toad there hopping along. A lot of nature. Hello there, sir. But as we come around this turn and you start kind of going uphill just a little bit, you might want to move, buddy. You're going to get hit by a bike probably. As you come around that turn and we're working our way up, there's going to be a little bridge up here. You're going to see a teeny little bridge halfway about here, 3,000 meters. So somewhere in here, you can check that watch if you're doing the 3K mark. Okay, this is not a weird camera angle effect. We are in fact hitting up a pretty significant uphill right here. Now it's not terribly long, but it is fairly steep. And so when it comes to running up a hill, when it's me doing the racing, the running, I keep my arms and legs moving the same speed. Now I'm gonna slow down because if I'm taking the same exact number of steps, each step isn't as far because I'm going up a hill. So you will technically slow down, but then when you get to the top, your pace resumes. That way you're not making any sudden changes. Other coaches say, charge the hill, attack the hill, sprint the hill. Fine, I'm sure there's merit to everything. Personally, I like maintaining my rhythm. Downhill, as fast as I can go without crashing. Uphill, maintain the rhythm. And when you get to the top, don't slow down. People that charge the hill, they get to the top, they slow down too much, which is why I'm not a huge fan of that that method. But again, everyone has their own opinion. So up the hill we go. So we're gonna pump those arms and keep that pace, keep that rhythm consistent. Okay, so we just went up the hill and then had a long straightaway. At the end of the straightaway is the 3200, the 2 mile mark. Most race courses, a lot of people are gonna be here because our course, the way it is, the 2 miles, kind of way in the middle of nowhere. You might not see anyone here, but you have your watch, you can always check your pace. If there is someone here, they might give you time or whatever. So 2 mile mark right here as we loop back around to head into our third and final mile of the race. Okay. So that little section is pretty wide open for any passing. Now we're heading back into some narrows. Quick downhill, quick uphill, sharp turns. So as we're going through here, this is where maybe you plan to avoid the bikers, of course. Maybe this is where you plan to catch up to somebody, pass somebody before you go into this little location, or just get on someone's shoulder and kind of ride them through until it opens up again. Okay, so at this point we're kind of emerging from the trees pretty much for the last time. There's one more short little stretch, but for the most part you're in the wide open now. This is where your spectators are going to be, tons of them, yelling and screaming. This is where us coaches, we haven't seen you for quite a while, and so we see any changes, any passing that people may have made. So when you get out here, we're going to take a right. We're going to be running around the entire open field. And what that means is, it means that you can see everyone that's in front of you. And what you have to realize is that there's still a lot of time left. People think, I'm in the third mile, and now we're out in the open, and oh man, we're at the finish. No, you are so far away. So you've got more than, you know, more than 3/4 of a mile, 3 laps of a track. So tons of time. So you put your eyes out there, maybe not at the next person, but maybe 3 people up or 4 people up or a pack that's up there, and you just start working because they might be dying and they know that you can see them, and so they're nervous. So when you come out here, this is kind of a spot to kind of reassess where you're at and to not be afraid to look at this. Okay, that person up there, I can still get that person. So great spot here to, like I said, kind of feel recharged. You're going to have your teammates, your coaches, your people yelling and screaming right here. You get that surge of adrenaline. You just kind of say, okay, here we go, and let's go get some people. Now, you'll notice there's a big, huge finish line right here. That's not us. That is the 3-mile Bloomer course. So that will slowly fade away because they are not racing here anymore this season. So this will slowly fade as the grass grows and gets clipped. That'll fade away, and it'll just be our line going to the right here, right through this tree. So again, the line tells you where your turns are. So as we go through here, we're going to be going around the tree, around a fire pit, and that whole line of trees, runners gonna be on this side of it. You will see, anyone's in front of you, you'll see them all. So you'll have plenty of people to look at and chase, perhaps. If you're not towards the front, you'll see plenty of people up there, teammates and otherwise. So pick someone, say, okay, I wanna get that person right there, get that jersey. Okay, so that section right there was a repeat. Remember on the way out I said straight, don't follow the tree line. Same thing, straight, don't follow the tree line. Now, we came from over there, but we're hanging left here. There'll be some cones to go around, so those are your barriers. It's a slight, very, very mild zigzag before we go up the trees. So that's where we're headed right now, right along here. So the line's gonna go here, there'll be a cone to go around, a cone to go around, and we're going up the trees. Now, to be honest, at this point in the race, you should not be looking at your watch. You're feeling terrible or you're feeling strong. You're just getting through it. You're catching people because you feel strong, or you're just holding on because you feel like you're dead. So at this point, if I see you looking at your watch, I'm gonna yell at you, stop looking at your watch. But that being said, this right here, this short little uphill, is the 4,000 meter mark. So if you're feeling good and strong, you got your race plan, you just gonna check, good. If you're dying, don't look. It's not gonna give you any positivity at all. Even if the time is good, it's not gonna make you stop feeling like you're dying. So if you're dying, stop looking at the watch. If you're feeling good, really no point looking at the watch, keep on going, speed up. Okay, now this line is actually accurate for our course. This is the line on our way out. That was the halfway point of the race. This is the line bringing us back. There will be ginormous, huge arrows done in such a way that will make it impossible to miss which way you're supposed to go. But obviously going this way, there's no choice. You're just blending back in, and we're gonna basically retrace the last bit of our race course. Now, the part that we did at the beginning from the mile on, we're gonna retrace that backwards until we get to the mile mark. So right here, our course is right along the parking lot, and it shifts over. Right there, you've got 800 meters left. And I don't tell you that so that you look at your watch and try to do math in your head. I tell you that so that you realize just how much time you still have, 2 laps of the track, with everybody in various different levels of fatigue, some dying, some feeling strong. So you still got a lot of time left which means the race isn't over, so you can still catch a lot of people, or hopefully not, but people can still catch you, so don't just give up. You still got a lot to go. Those two laps, 800 meters. So a good place to check and realize I got a lot of time left. I can still go. Should we be sprinting with 800 left? Absolutely not. We're not there yet, but it gives you an idea just where you are in the race. Lots of time left. Okay, fans everywhere here, spectators, finish line's over there. We still gotta go around our loop. What I have here is this sign. This sign, when I get right next to it on my line as I'm running, so as I get to about here, and I see that sign, 400 meters, quarter mile, one lap of the track left from right here. Stronger runners with some experience, this is where they're gonna start to make a final push. Newer runners pushing for a whole lap after running over 2 miles might be a little bit beyond what you're capable of yet, but it is what you're working towards. I've seen plenty of races come through right here with the leader and a sizable distance between second place, and second place catches them or almost gets them. So there's still a lot of racing to be had right here at this 400 meter mark. So this is kind of where it's kind of a gut check time, okay? Time to go, time to hold someone off, or time to maybe catch somebody. All right, well, as we near the light at the end of our tunnel here, our time together is about up. So hopefully you get a good idea of what this course looks like, maybe some racing strategy. But as we approach this opening right here, once we get to that opening, we will have about 85 meters left. So basically the straightaway of our track, that's how much time is left. So at this point, anything you got left, time to put it in there. If you saved up too much energy, hey, nothing you can do about that now except sprint for all you're worth. If you if you've just completely tapped yourself out because you hit the pace and you're just dying, good job. Just get to that finish. Keep your legs under you. Focus on those arms. If your arms keep moving, your legs got to follow, right? So as we approach our opening here, you might recognize this. This was the 1 mile mark coming this way on our way out. So we're coming back in. There's gonna be a line telling you go right that way, right towards those birch trees. And as you go through, you'll see the timers, you'll see the flags, you'll see people yelling and screaming and all that. And you just gotta get there. And that's the end of our course. That's 5,000 meters. So let's get there and figure out how the ending works. All right, so that's the end of our race. You got the cricket pitch right there. So that's usually right around here is where our finish line is gonna be. Now, some races are timed electronically. You've got a little sensor on your number, your bib, and you go across and the computer recognizes you and you're done. Other times, we have to do it manually, old school. And that's probably what we're gonna be doing pretty much all of our races. So when you cross the finish line, your place at that finish line is your place in the race. Anything that happens after that doesn't count. But you have to make sure that you get credit for where you finished. So every time you finish a cross-country race, you're going to have a whole lot of grumpy-sounding adults yelling at you, keep moving, keep jogging, keep moving, run through the chute, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. They're doing that so that the finish line doesn't get all clogged up. And for us, it's important that we keep doing that because as you come through, I hit a button for you. I got a time. And that time is maybe, I don't know, pick it, 17th place. And that's you, 17th place. But if you don't get the 17th ticket, if you don't get credit for 17th place, then you don't get credit for 17th place. So you got to make sure you finish your race, right? You come through, you finish your race, you get your place, but you got to make sure you get into the line in the right location. So if you're sprinting through, your momentum should carry through. Don't slam on the brakes. That's bad for your legs anyways. Your momentum should carry right through. When we paint the course, I have the finish line, the line that shows you where to go. We keep that line going. So that kind of gives you a subliminal, keep on following the line until you get to the little narrow spot. Once you're in the narrows, people can't pass you. You can put your hands out or whatever else. Okay? If you're coming through the line and you just kind of, you just get there and now you're really staggering and someone comes flying through, well, they're not expected to slam on their brakes. They might pass you. They're not trying to cheat. They're just going to slow down, and if they know what's going on and they are, you know, if they're honest, they might fly by you, but they're going to stop and they're going to turn and look and they're going to wait for you. They might even say, come on, come on, come on, because they know the right way to do things. So don't think that someone's trying to cheat because they'll go flying by you. That just means that they finished faster. But you beat them, you get the time. So make sure you get credit for your race. Okay, so that's our 5K here at Bloomer. So we talked about some of the things on the course, talked about some things just in general, and that's it. So next time we're out here will be Wednesday, and hopefully our painting machines are ready to go by then, and we have some lines, and we'll get a chance to have our first 5K race of the 2020 season. Some of you veteran runners are looking to run your best time ever, which would be great, and some of you new runners are looking to race 5,000 meters for the first time. So excited to see that happen. So we will see you at practice today for some workout drills, but then Wednesday we'll be here for our race. He's going the distance. He's going